Welcome to the Reintegrate Podcast. My name is Bob Robinson and my co-host is Brendan Romine. Today's guest is Stephanie Summers. She is the CEO of the Center for Public Justice in Washington, D.C. She is a speaker, a moderator, and an author. She has written articles for Comment Magazine, Q Ideas. She has wrote an excellent article for me when I was editing for The High Calling. That article can be found this week at the Reintegrate blog at Pathos. Go to re-integrate.org to find that. I've known Stephanie for a while now. I had the privilege of serving under her leadership when she was a vice president for the CCO, the Coalition for Christian Outreach, about a decade ago. I'm excited to have Stephanie on this episode right before Election Day, because we need to understand what it looks like to be disciples of Jesus and how that affects our politics. She has some great insights to share with us about political discipleship and how Election Day really isn't the end of our political discipleship, but just the beginning. Here's our conversation with Stephanie Summers. You're with the Center for Public Justice, the CPJ. Could you give our audience an introduction to the work of the CPJ? What do you do so they can tap into the resources that the center has?
Sure, I'd be happy to. And thanks for having me in this conversation today. It's really a joy. So the Center for Public Justice is a civic education and public policy organization. So let me unpack that. The work that we do is equip citizens, we develop leaders, and we shape policy. And we are Christian, we're not partisan. And we do our work through a variety of programs. On the kind of equip citizens civic education side, we do a lot of our work through groups that we help people form called political discipleship groups, which is really a way to help Christians navigate the complexity of entering into what does it mean to be an engaged citizen who is a Christian, who doesn't fit neatly into a partisan spot, who is trying to navigate that in some public way. Folks learn habits that are really important for a lifelong journey of political discipleship. And they also get to maybe critically examine some of the things that have influenced their political thinking that may be more partisan than Christian. And then as they're, you know, kind of examining those things and maybe leaving those behind, adopting some new habits for the future, like discernment or how to understand someone who doesn't think just like you. They work together to identify an issue of concern in their local community, a public policy issue, and then they work on that public policy issue together. They meet with public officials to talk about the issue in their community. And the groups are really diverse, right? They're picking the things that are of most urgent need within their own local context.
That's fascinating, because so much of politics nowadays is just national, national, national. But it seems like we're missing the fact that most policy, most politics that affects us the most is what? Local, right?
Yes, that's 100% true. And we look often at Washington. In some ways, it's not your fault that we look there, right? Because a lot of what happens in DC is projected out as spectacle, right? So it's captivating, right? It's either entertaining or sort of like blood sport, right? It has this component to it that gets broadcast, right? That's not necessarily all that's happening. There's all kinds of good work that's happening that is not being broadcast, except maybe on C-SPAN. There's so much of what's happening that really affects people's lives, that is being decided at the most local level, right? So sometimes we misplace where we aim our advocacy efforts, as Christians, especially if we have not, paid attention necessarily to, hey, this is actually decided in my local community. We might say, the school discipline policies in my school district really need to change, and we want to work on that at the federal Department of Education, where really all of those school discipline policies are actually getting made by the local school board, who either is elected by the voters in that community or appointed by someone like the mayor, right? The juvenile probation system, right? You know, we want to, many people have a deep concern to stop, so many kids from ending up in the criminal justice system for things that are minor offenses like skipping school, right? The probation system is totally decided at the local level and has really no, oversight or any kind of connection to any criminal justice policy that's happening at the federal level, right? The great thing about focusing at the local level is you really can see change come to fruition. And in many ways, you have the opportunity within the local community to provide a set of resources to the issue that are holistic, right? Often things that need public policy solutions also need solutions from other institutions in society, right? They need, people have resource needs, they have spiritual needs, they have all kinds of other, things that can be addressed at the most local level. And the opportunity for the people of God within the context of the local church or as tutors in the local school can address a whole bunch of things. At the same time, the local church isn't setting the school discipline policy, right? So we have to wear our citizen hat when we're going and working for better policies, but we can certainly be tutors and help kids learn to read in third grade, which, happens to be one of the most important things to stop a child from getting involved in the criminal justice system is if they're literate by third grade. So there's all these opportunities, but when we sort of are like totally focused on politics as national or totally focused on politics as about the president and the presidential election, we miss all these opportunities to really love our neighbors through politics.
I just handed in my absentee ballot at the local, at our county electoral board in. And so I'm filling it out. I'm like, it's just so hard to, I'm like just combing the internet for resources
yes.
for anybody to talk about any of these local candidates and local issues.
Right. Yeah, it's a common problem, right? So there's sort of two things, right? When we think about how we're formed, so this is one of the things that we do with the political discipleship groups, right? With this whole session called Political Autobiographies. And it's designed both to help people reflect on their political formation. It's also designed to help depolarize a group because, really we have this, real challenge that the church has become just as polarized. And clearly that's not Christ's intent. Christ's intent is the unity of the body, right? But somehow we've, kind of adopted sort of partisanship as a proxy. And we've brought that into the church. And so their church is really divided over politics, whether that's, the church more broadly or the church locally, within, one's own community, one's own congregation, there's these dividing lines. And so these political autobiographies, you actually, part of your assignment, for homework that week is, go home and write about your own political formation. What are the things that loom large for you? And then as a group, the next week you come back and you share your stories. So if you were hearing my story, right? My story starts actually when I was 4, because my mom, who wanted to be in the Foreign Service in a time when women were actual secretaries, as opposed to the Secretary of State, had studied foreign policy, because she was hoping that's what she would do. And she was very deeply committed to free and fair elections. And so she worked the polls every election, even the off year elections when, 50 people would show up. And I would go to the polls with her. And as a 4-year-old, I just loved going because I got to read all day and nobody told me I had to go play outside. But probably when I was about 8 or 9, I came to a place where I started to ask questions about why we did this. And so even as a very young child, I understood the importance of what we were doing. And I remember one year where my former kindergarten teacher's husband was running for the mayor of our town. And I remember asking my mother, can I vote? I was probably like 10. And she was like, well, you're not old enough. And we had this whole conversation because I really wanted my former kindergarten teacher's husband to win because I had been to their house. I knew he cared about the community. You know, those things that I, you know, kind of had been formed by from my mom's kind of tutoring of me about these things over the years were really the motivations of my heart, was someone who cared about everyone in this community. That's a different political formation story, right, than someone whose story begins because they were a refugee, right? Or someone whose story begins by saying, I never thought about this at all until I was 18. And then I was like, ooh, somebody asked me if I'm going to vote. And I thought I better, right? I felt sort of guilty and I didn't really know what I was going to do or why. Those are different stories. Right. But it really helps, you know, kind of unlock the ways that we've been formed. And it also helps unlock the ways we've been formed, not in great ways. So to go back to the thing about free and fair elections, right? So you have these free and fair elections. And one of the things that's really great when you go to vote in person in before COVID times, you know, you are by yourself. And because no one should be tampering with your vote, right? No one should be putting undue influence on you to vote for who they want you to vote for. But it forms you when you're on a solo like that to really think only about you, right? You don't take often, most people don't take into the voting booth their community and think, what is the choice that I'm making now to benefit the well-being of my entire community? There aren't a lot of resources for you to find, right? Your own discovery, Bob, of like, where am I going to get this? Most communities, the way they get it is through their local paper. And with, you know, the decline of local news, that's really a challenge to see be as robust in many, many communities around the country. And so the opportunity we have to say, okay, well, we're going to host a forum or we're going to find out what these jobs are. And we're going to have people who are really good at researching that go do the work. And we're going to have other folks who know someone who works in city planning, go talk to that person, helps us kind of marshal the resources that we can then share with the community, not just the church.
What else does the Center for Public Justice do?
Yeah, so I talked about we equip citizens, we develop leaders. So our leadership development, we work a lot with the leaders of faith-based organizations to align their kind of practices with their faith. We also help the organizations develop good public witness. And then the last thing is we work directly on public policy. We work in coalition. We always work with other organizations. That's really a hallmark of our work. And we work with organizations that don't all agree with each other on everything. It's this interesting privilege to be able to kind of convene these conversations where we're really trying to get very practical about what solutions are needed to solve some of the biggest challenges in our society. You know, as Christian people, we, you know, are often people who have deep pro-life commitments. And the way that the public policy debate around abortion is very fraught and very binary debate. You know, the reality is for there to be fewer abortions, there actually needs to be public policy that would help support really vulnerable financially people who are choosing abortion. And this is typically Black and brown women who economically are kind of at the lowest point and economically are thinking, I don't want to bring a child into this world that where I'm hanging by a thread. And that's a place where then we do work to say, okay, well, what types of public policies would need to be in place? Well, we would actually need to have some kind of paid family leave, right? So the woman who's working at McDonald's doesn't have to go back to work the next day because she doesn't have any leave after she has her baby, right? Mm-hmm. An opportunity for moms to actually be able to nurse their children and bond with their baby, have a medical recovery, which takes weeks and weeks and weeks, not 24 hours. Those types of things all lead to better lifetime health outcomes, but they also lead to abortion reduction. Because there's opportunities in place as opposed to someone thinking, I have to work or I can't do this and I can't have this baby and work. And so, you know, how am I going to make this work? We try to work upstream of those problems. It's hard because, right, most of the way that these public policy challenges get communicated are as binaries. It's either you got to choose this or choose this, right? And most often the solutions are not binary solutions, right? They're actually solutions that are comprehensive, right? They need government to do work. They need civil society institutions to do work. They need families that are strong. They need, you know, jobs, all these pieces, right, need to kind of come together. And so part of, you know, what we're trying to discern in voting, which is only one piece, right? Voting is only one piece of our citizenship, right? And particularly like voting, you know, once every 4 years is one actually very small piece. The president is not the CEO of the nation setting the policy for the whole nation. And so, you know, the challenge we have is that kind of all of our energy gets focused there. And again, understandably, because it is certainly broadcast as spectacle and it matters. It is not of no consequence. But we have all these other opportunities to really invest in thinking about the solutions that need to be there. We don't not every person needs to, you know, be focused on every single thing, right? I'm often at a place where, you know, I'm trying to remind people like their, you know, focus on like a thing that you can do within the context of your community. Focus on the pressing thing. You know, your community has a lack of affordable housing or a lack of transportation access, or, you know, has a bunch of payday lenders that are set up in your community that are, you know, essentially set up in neighborhoods to entrap poor people further. Those types of things, you know, choose one of those and work on them together. So it's why even by design with political discipleship, we're trying to help groups like try it and learn some of these habits that you can keep using, you know, any day of the year, not just on election day.
It sounds like a lot of politics is working together to do things for the common good. And today's politics seems like anything but that, right?
Yes.
It's like the divisions, the political divisions within churches, to the point of, I see that person as the enemy because they're in that other tribe, that other camp, and I'm in this camp. So what is a route forward for us as Christians?
Politics somehow has been very disordered, and partisanship in particular, right? This team choice and the demonization of other brothers and sisters in Christ, right? We need to be people who work and pray for unity in the church, right? And there are calls right now for national unity. I think we're wise as Christians if we think about the ways that we are not united in our own body and put some energy there, both in prayer, but also in really working to listen to people who, and spend time with people who are not like us, not so I can get in an argument with them, but so I can really understand who they are and where they're coming from. Pretty often, because we, you know, like any team sport, we sort of display the banners of our team or we wear the shirt, hat. We're not getting past that in our conversations. So we're essentially relating to a caricature. And that's not how one learns how to navigate difference successfully, right? The only way people really learn is by experience with people who are different and coming to understand the perspective of the other. And then I think there is this piece, right, where we often will find ourselves where we can talk about how we're united in Christ, but we really are divided on some other things. And those things are often judgment calls. Right. And right now, one of the things that is in the church fight or the disunity or the dividing lines is that we've elevated those things to matters of faith. So they're almost, if you don't believe this, you're a heretic, right? You're not a Christian. If you, you know, X, you're going to vote for this person, you can't be a Christian. That is putting politics into a different place than Christ certainly intends politics to be. That is giving it an ultimate that it is, you know, for the good, but it is not for the ultimate, right? And if it is dividing us as God's people, we've moved it to a different place than it ought to have. Sometimes we achieve disagreement and it's okay to name that. And we can stay united even though we know we disagree about something, right? and the recognition that we have more in common because of Christ is a bigger help to us than in also being able to say, okay, we might have achieved disagreement here, and we've named that, but there's actually some other things we probably do agree on. So what can we do together, right? And then we're back into the place where we can actually do some good stuff in our community because we agree.
And that disagreement doesn't have to be an inherently bad thing. Really, the timing of this topic was kind of fortuitous because this past Sunday, I teach a high school small group. So I have a group of about 10 high school senior boys that who all meet in my house. And it's a very organized, no rowdiness at all. But
none.
There was the passage from 1 Peter that talks about like basically a Christian civic duty.
Yeah.
And the duty to their government, pay respect to respect, who's owed, honor to honor, who's owed. And then they put that along with the passage in Romans where Paul talks along a very similar set of lines about civic duty and your involvement and that respect and everything. And so I spun that off into a discussion about politics. Like I kind of went around the room and I wanted to hear from them. Like, what do you guys think it means to be a Christian and to engage with politics? Like how do you guys assume that you should think, And I was actually frankly really refreshed because there's a bunch of 17 and 18 year old boys and all of them were pretty nuanced in their opinions. Most of them one way or another were like, honestly, this is all really confusing because, and that especially in, big surprise, this very binary picture that's been painted of the current American political scene. Most of these guys are like, I don't really see Jesus completely in one side or the other side. Mm-hmm. Maybe parts of it, but I don't see, and some of them even talked, were talking from like family members and people in our church that they were talking to. Some of them were very much, it is your Christian duty to vote for candidate A. And one of them said the opposite, is your Christian duty to vote for candidate B. And so they're listening to these adults being super dogmatic, even about the election on both ends.
Well, and it's hard, I think, too, right? The, your students are actually very, very astute in the sense that, they're not going to find Jesus on the ballot. And so you are making decisions that are always going to be proximate, right? That you're looking for the thing that is the closest, right? And you are making decisions when you're voting, with not possibly being able to know all the information, right? And it's part of the, kind of going back to that thing I was talking about with the body, sort of, learning together. It's also an opportunity to be deliberative together, right? Deliberation is another component that we build into this political discipleship group. In part because we've really lost our ability to do it, right? We are trying to convince each other as opposed to deliberate together about the merits of, all of the possibilities that one should consider, even, beyond maybe the two, have many more things we can consider. Just from working in these coalitions, I can tell you that quite often, a group that has learned how to deliberate together can actually achieve disagreement as a group where, you've got a whole group that's committed to a particular issue, but the how of how the work's going to get done, we really disagree with each other. And we can disagree with each other and make commitments to one another of like, we're going to walk out of this room, we're going to work on these things in different ways, and we're not going to trash each other, right? Because that's not what we do as people in the body of Christ, right? And so we're not going to say, boy, I couldn't persuade Bob to see it my way. Instead, I'm going to hope that, Bob sees it my way because I do think I'm right. But I'm not going to sabotage or trash Bob. I'm going to figure out how we can possibly work together because we care about the same thing.
The way to treat each other right, even when we do disagree, and to deliberate through disagreement and even, being at peace with that disagreement. I think that's something that is uniquely empowered within the Christian frame of mind. because I think if you're truly engaging with politics from the heart of Christ, then you are seeing everyone as a child of God, and you understand the way that person needs to be treated by default, you know, at bare minimum, even if you're furious mm-hmm. with them. And it seems like our society, you know, and again, on the right and the left, has just in that area taken a nosedive.
But think about why people become uncivil. People become uncivil because they aren't being heard, right? And one of the challenges, right, is that we have a lot of issues where people have not been heard. And so the way that that has built over time has led to, you know, a back and forth that basically looks like I'm screaming because I'm trying to be heard and you're not hearing me. It unfortunately just is in this kind of a cycle, and then it becomes kind of vicious in its, you know, okay, now not only are you not listening to me, but you are a bad human being, right? And, you know, then it's just kind of a back and forth in that way. That kind of coarsening of the discourse is something that I think can be interrupted. But we have to have people in the room who are willing to say things like, wait, we need to be able to listen, right? That I think that's the place where, just like any opportunity we ever have to understand someone else who isn't us, like myself, I have to be able to do more listening, right? I have to be able to ask questions. And that is a choice for me to not, you know, be trying to figure out how I'm going to get into the conversation, the point I really want to make.
So we were talking a lot about election and our one vote. As my wife and I drove down to the county board of elections, every time I just feel like this really doesn't matter. It's just one vote among the millions. So it doesn't, why do I even bother? But there's more to politics than election day.
Yes.
What else should we be thinking about?
Yes. Oh, absolutely. Great question. So, you know, for me, I like to think about, you know, election day as actually the beginning of opportunity we have to commit ourselves to being more politically engaged than we have been to that moment. And, you know, it's in part because, you know, we view the presidential election as sort of like the end, kind of either I've done my duty or thank goodness that's over. And now we'll just, you know, I don't have to think about this again for four more years. One of the things that is really an opportunity, right, is thinking about the needs that are in our local communities. If it's possible for you to just not think about public policy or politics, unless you know, it's sort of intervening in your life in a, you know, media way, right? You're encountering it on Facebook, someone says something to you, you know, you see a sign, but your life doesn't feel like it is impacted on a daily basis by the decisions that are being made within your local community, then you're probably not very attuned to the needs in your community. And I'm saying that as an invitation, not an indictment. But, you know, part of it is tuning into the needs that many people in communities have for justice that are not the needs that some other members of the community ever experience or have to worry about. And saying, it's not okay if I'm a person who's called to love my neighbor, that I ignore these needs in this community. Now, we don't have to fix every single thing, right? The world's not ours to save, right? But we can love our neighbors through politics, right? We can do things that are going to help have a better set of outcomes because of more just policies in our communities, right? Whether that's a school discipline policy, whether that's a probation reforms, whether that's making sure that the, you know, you know, these are very unglamorous things, but that the sewer system or the water treatment runs better, you know, runs as well, as opposed to better in certain neighborhoods and crappier in others. You know, pollution often gets routed through poor neighborhoods, through causeways and waterways. You know, are we okay with that? Because it certainly has really bad health outcomes for our neighbors. Those are the types of things that we can pay attention to in our local communities that are the everyday stuff of politics, not the election day stuff of politics. And we really have an opportunity to invest in and change. It takes work. So it's a serious invitation. And there are going to be people who are the professionals, right, who are going to be the elected officials who do the work. But there are also going to be people who are the active volunteers or the advocates who are going to help. And I think considering what those things are in our own community is a good place to start the day after Election Day.
Yeah, it's easy to kind of lump every person in public service as that person who's greedy and power mad. And so, not that we haven't ever seen that at the national level, people who have been in office forever who are greedy or power hungry. Sure. So, but hard to think that the trustee on the local board of your township is power mad, because that's what he's trying to do is serving his community that way. But
right. And it's hard. I mean, with politics in particular, right? The politics is by its nature public, right? So it's about public issues of public concern. So it's on display in a way that, you know, you can look at almost any enterprise or institution you've ever been involved in and say, yes, there are things about this that are a mess, right? That's a true testimony about the power of the fall in the world, right? That things are disordered.
Everything is disordered. But,
right, the whole thing. Right. Politics feels like it's in a special category, right? But it's not. It's in the same category. It's just we see so much more of it in a way that we're not looking at with the same level of scrutiny or access to all kinds of other institutions that have been as severely impacted, as off course. And so, you know, our response to it is to really, you know, unfortunately, like, demonize the people who are in it, when, you know, in many cases, the people who are in it lament the same things that we are lamenting when we are observing the lamentable things. And so, you know, how to reshape our thinking about that, I think, is a crucial piece as well.
All right, thanks.
Yeah, thank you both.
That was great having you on the show, Stephanie. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you.
It was wonderful.